Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the United States, here in North Carolina. Anyway, I just wanted to announce, got a preach a little bit of a preaching schedule going on here and a tentative schedule. Okay, I'm trying to see if this microphone, some people said they couldn't hear it. You know, I don't know. It's a $2 microphone. Anyway, I'll be at a place called Freedom Baptist Church. You know, guys, I'm an evangelical or born again, spirit filled Christian. I go to every denomination. There are some people that think everybody's going to hell if they're not a Baptist, and people that think the Baptists are going to hell. And, you know, all this denominational stuff is not my thing, because God's got his people everywhere and the devil's got his people everywhere. You know, going to, as the famous Billy Sunday say, going to church makes you a Christian about as much as sitting in a car garage makes you a car. So, the place is called Freedom Baptist Church. I'll be there at the 6 p.m. service on August the 25th. It's like a week and a half from now. And the church is located about 15 minutes away from Morganton, North Carolina, on Highway 64. So it's if you would Google that, Freedom Baptist Church, near Morganton, North Carolina. It's almost at the foothills there, almost at the edge of the mountains, off of Interstate 40, and then you go up 64. I forgot. I think it's east, maybe, or whatever it is. You can Google that. Anyway, so if you're anywhere near there and you'd like to come, 6 p.m. On Sunday night, the 25th of August. Okay, brothers and sisters, after that date, I'll be coming back here. Before that date, I don't have the final date. I'm waiting to hear back from the people. But there's just some people that asked me to meet them. And we're going to meet somewhere in Greensboro, North Carolina. Maybe and have lunch or maybe Starbucks in Greensboro, North Carolina. There's a brother. His last name is Petty. I can remember that because of Richard Petty, the famous, you know, here in North Carolina. You know, we have our, they say, there's a saying of that my brother used to say, the three R's of being a redneck is a red dog, wrestling with an R, and racing. You know, that's just kind of a joke that we used to say when I was a teenager. Brother Petty also lives in Greensboro, and you know, I mentioned his last name on here. He lives in that area. We can meet, and some other people also who live around that area. Anybody Greensboro, North Carolina, either next Tuesday or Thursday, message me if you can be there, and I will lock in a place where we can meet with these other people who are coming up from Raleigh. And we can have just a spontaneous Bible study and talk about the end times. That's what the people are asking me, to talk about the end times with them. Just an informal discussion and maybe Starbucks or something. So that will be this coming Tuesday or Thursday next week. So whatever that is, that's like the, whatever it may be, the 18th, 20th, whatever it is. Something like that. Message me and we'll work it out. So I'll be in Greensboro, North Carolina next Tuesday or Thursday to meet with people. Next Sunday, the 25th of August, near Morganton, North Carolina, at Freedom Baptist Church, 6 p.m. service. After that, there's some several people in South Carolina, but some are way down near Charleston, some at Myrtle Beach, and some in the upstate. So maybe we can meet in Columbia, South Carolina, anyone who wants to meet me. Or if I get enough people from the, you know, Charlotte area, Rock Hill area of South Carolina versus down in Charleston, maybe we can meet there in Columbia or even in Rock Hill or something, you know, up there. Again, we can eat lunch, Starbucks or something. That will be, let's say, the 27th. 27th of August. I'll come back here from Morganton, stay back here in this area, have to pack up all the stuff and all that the next day on Monday. So Tuesday, August the 27th, be heading down into South Carolina, and I will stop, you know, and spend the afternoon there with people, whatever. We'll end up going to Atlanta area after that, either that night of the 27th or the 28th. I got to look at the calendar. I guess that's still early for I don't want to be driving during Labor Day weekend. I will spend that from the 27th night or the 28th night through Labor Day. We will be in the Atlanta area. There's a brother and sister there who invited us to stay with them. They're in the Atlanta area. We will be there. So if anyone wants to meet with me, we can meet at a Starbucks, as long as it's, you know, I don't know my way around. Let's meet in a, you know, because in a safe place, at a Starbucks or a restaurant or whatever, or, you know, somebody's house, we can meet, whatever. And because I can't speak for these people I'm staying with, you know, that, hey, you can come to their house. We can meet in a public place or at your house or whatever. So, you know, I'm just trying to see the most people and do the most good. So I'm just doing this by ear as God would lead. If anyone that has a church along this route, after I leave Atlanta, after Labor Day, like the next day or the next day when the traffic dies down, it's dangerous to drive during that time, you know, that lots of drunks and stuff. So after the Labor Day weekend, which will be like the second, the third, start somewhere around in there, the third or fourth of September, I'll be leaving the Atlanta area and going to Louisiana. Now, if there's anybody along that route between Atlanta and, say, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, you know, I could, if they want me to come and preach, do a Bible study, spend the night or whatever along the way, let me know. That's the route I'm taking. I can go off that route a little bit along that way. You know, it don't have to be a straight line, but somewhere in that vicinity, you know, Mississippi, Alabama, across through there. There are some people from Alabama that's contacted me, but it's been a long time and I don't remember. So just let me know, brothers and sisters. And then I'll be in that, what the Lord is leading me to do is I will stay in the Baton Rouge and Montgomery, in the Baton Rouge area of Louisiana, all around there, for probably at least a couple of weeks to settle my family there. We've got a two-year-old, let them rest, you know, there, and then I can work out from there like a, you know, spokes of a wheel. Go to churches. There's a church there somewhere in that area, close by there, that has invited me to preach, and, you know, I got to set the date with them. I'm, you know, if you watch this, brother, I got to look at my notes where I've written it down because it's been several months since we talked, to do a revival there. So I'll announce that when the time comes. That will be in September. Okay, and then by the 1st of October, by the grace of God, I'll be in the Houston area. There's many people, the vast majority of people who contacted me. I don't know if it's the vast majority of viewers. The vast majority of people contacting me are in the East Texas area, Louisiana area. So I will be near Houston and for, by the grace of God, maybe the whole month of October. And again, settle my family in one spot with, you know, family support of, you know, some subscribers there. You know, my wife and son can have a support and connections and friends there because my wife is new in the country and then we have a two-year-old. And then I'll be, you know, free to, you know that they're doing good. And then I can go out from there, go to Dallas, do revivals, do Bible studies at people's houses, all that stuff we talked about, Katy, Texas, all around East Texas and all through that whole area within, say, a four-hour drive of, you know, Austin, San Antonio, whatever. All those places. And there's many viewers in those areas. So just let me know. We'll coordinate that for the month of October. Okay. Then after that, now I don't know what all I'll go in between. As I mentioned before, if someone, there's people invited me to do like a revival in LA. It's so far, you know, to go and all the days I could be doing, you know, ministry. I would pray that if some church really wants me to come, that they will, you know, coordinate with me and make a, get an airline ticket. I could just hop out there, like leave my family there in the Houston area or in Louisiana in September, hop out there, you know, do a 2 or 3 day revival or whatever and come back, whatever. It's up to the Lord. Anywhere, anywhere in the United States, I'll go as long as we coordinate it. I'm open to that and have a base for my family. So that's the plan. And anyway, November, I plan on getting down to Florida. There's many viewers in Florida. Maybe that's the biggest group. There's a huge group of subscribers and people that want me to, you know, baptize and all that kind of stuff in Florida. So I'm planning on going to Florida in November. Now there's people on up there at St. Louis, even Chicago, Indiana, all through those places. I want to come up there too. As the Lord leads me, I'll coordinate that. I'll be back in the United States anyway again in next June. I'll be back in the United States next year in June. We'll go to the Philippines because my wife has to spend 6 months a year in the United States. So you're going back in December, coming back to the United States next June. And so maybe that will be the time. It's up to the Lord. I mean, I don't know what I'll be able to get done. I mean, you know, I don't want to, I want to go every place, but now God can make a way and give me the energy, the money and the time and to do that. Or he may just, revival may break out in one place. I may not get past Atlanta. I may not get past Louisiana. You know what I'm saying? I'm totally walking by faith in whatever the Lord wants to do. As much as the Lord wants to do or as little as he wants to do. You know, there's been times I walked in the mountains in the Philippines through NPA area, which is the New People's Army, through communist-held territory, and then I evangelized four people and prayed for them to get saved. And these people were witches. Something called the third eye. There's a name for the religious group. They wear this ring. It's kind of like a class ring, and then they look through it and see stuff, and the nickname for them is called the third eye group or whatever. And these people were demonized and attacked by demons. Every day at the same time, they became possessed by demons, and the demons tried to drag their souls into the pit. and this group of people I met in the mountains. And I walked through the mountains. You know, where we went was like 2 days from civilization. I walked through the mountains. And along the way, I met other people. But this one group, we went all the way, you know, hours extra in the middle of nowhere for four people. You know, so, the Bible says, despise not the day of small things. So for me, if I'm going to go speak to one person, or I've spoken to thousands of people. I preached to groups of thousands of people at one time in the Philippines. And it doesn't matter to me. It doesn't move me. When I was new in the ministry, I said, oh, wow, I got to speak to 10,000 people. But that doesn't move me, because sometimes when you get in a situation, they want you to sell your soul. You know, the people in charge of it are like, well, we're going to let you preach, but you can't say this and you can't say that. See, they try to get you to compromise and sell your soul. That's how the devil always works. You know, just like with Jesus in the temptation, you know, I'll give you power. You know, I have the power over all the kings on the earth if you just bow down and worship me. You know, when Jesus was tempted, you know, and so we get in those situations where, you know, if in our flesh we're all fired up about speaking to 10,000 people or whatever it is, and then we despise those small things, that's where God will, you know, will deal with us and humble us. So for me, it doesn't matter. But while I'm here, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to do the most good for the most people in the least amount of time. So that's, you know, that's what I'm up against. And that's why I asked you guys again, please message me. Please contact me if you want me to come. I need to know. I can't know if you don't tell me. If you need to be water baptized, if you have unsaved relatives who are willing to let me pray for them and evangelize them, you know, maybe they've been evangelized, but they haven't had a spirit-filled person lay hands on them. If you come especially like from a Baptist background, or Catholic background and all that stuff, maybe you've never been exposed to the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm not going to be, maybe people have seen on TV, people get wacky and all that stuff. You know, the Bible says the spirit of prophecy is subject to the prophet. So in other words, we have control over ourselves. There's people that get on TV and get out of control and wallow around the floor and all that stuff. And, you know, sometimes the Lord might lead us to do that. But we also are not supposed to cause other people to stumble. Now, you know, I'm not like there's a guy that's a Baptist dude that makes videos, and he's always making fun of Pentecostal people, everything he does. But I like his teaching. I'm trying to think of his name. Haggard. Is it Hogan or Haggard is his last name? He wears glasses too. And he's always, and he talks about numerology and stuff, or gematria. And he's got good teachings, but he's always mocking the move of the Holy Spirit. But, you know, I just want to say this. I am a spirit-filled, spirit-baptized person, okay? But, you know, it's not God getting people to get down on the ground and bark like a dog, you know, in some of these charismatic churches. There's videos on YouTube you can see of that. Now, that is not the Lord getting people to bark like a dog and neigh like a horse and all that. So there's, you know, there's a fine line, and the devil loves to copy everything. But Jesus told us in Luke chapter 11, you know, which son asks his father for a fish and he gives him a scorpion, you know, or gives him, asks for bread and gives him a stone, you know. How you being evil know how to give your children good gifts. How much more does your heavenly Father, who's perfect, give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? So if we ask God to baptize in the Holy Spirit, he's not going to give us a demon, okay? And that's a lot of people's fear, you know, they don't want to have some false spirit. But if you ask in Jesus' name for the Holy Spirit, God's, you know, God would be a liar. Jesus would be a liar if Jesus let you become demon-possessed, because that's what the Lord said, Luke chapter 11, okay? So anyway, I'm a spirit-filled person, but I don't do anything that's going to cause anybody to stumble. The Spirit of God is a gentleman, and he, and his goal is to bring people, to draw people to salvation in Jesus Christ. Now, God does healings. He does all the things, speaking in tongues, all that stuff. All the gifts of the Spirit are available for us today as the Lord divides among us as he wills. So maybe you guys have, you know, lots of people have not been exposed to the power of the Holy Spirit and done properly and in order in God's way. And there's tons of people, you know, lots and I guess hundreds or thousands of people, I don't know, thousands of people I've laid hands on, and then they've never experienced the Holy Spirit like that. Maybe they felt it a little bit, but, you know, it's those kind of things that makes a difference. Or if I'm there physically preaching, or not only me, other people, I'm just, this, we're talking about this ministry right now. People experience the tangible presence of God, and they never have in their life. And then just through that, they know that God is real, and they know the gospel is real, because they've only heard it from dead religion. You know, so those are things that make a difference. And so if you are looking for your relatives who are, you know, who are open to at least be evangelized, prayed for, and all that, to be water baptized, if you desire to be physically healed, baptized in the Holy Spirit, just teaching and talking about the end times. Lots of people want to just talk to me about the end times. I do seminars on that in the Philippines. I've been studying the end times, and God has really made me a quote-unquote kind of an expert, self-taught by the Lord leading me in the end times. You know, and I can talk in circles all day long about the different theology and all that, all the different theories. You know, there's people that'll message me, they hear some theory on the internet. Oh, and this is it. Everything else is wrong. That's just a theory they heard, and it's not based in their own studies and their own conviction. Just what they heard, something that sounded good, and this has got to be it, and everybody's going to hell that doesn't believe what they believe. And but we can discuss all those theories. I love to talk about that. We can talk about atheism versus Christianity and all the proof of the existence of God and Jesus is the Christ, you know, the case for Christ, all of that stuff, any of those things. I love to talk about all those things. I'll be happy to meet people along the way. Stop. We can have lunch, have coffee, talk about it. People that want to talk about the orphanage, talk about the orphans. You want to talk about the feeding programs. You want to talk about the Bible school in the Philippines. You want to talk about, hey, you would like to visit the Philippines and feed some of the poor children. You want to come to the Philippines and help whatever, or the orphanage, Bible school, build a church, whatever. Let's do it. Whatever the Lord leads. You know, I'm open to all those things, whatever. You know, this is just, I'm trying to do it, you know, like in the book of Acts. I'm going around as the Lord leads, and I want you guys to be a part of it and help me do it. Let's do it together. I'll meet with you guys or whatever. I'm open to all ideas and all things to advance the kingdom of God and break the spirit of fear over the United States. The problem with most Christians in the United States, I need to make a video preaching. It's the spirit of fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. 2 Timothy 1:7. Lots of people in America that I listen to, Christians, oh, they're so afraid about the Antichrist, spirit of the Antichrist, Obama, whatever, blah, 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 the NSA. We have power over all those things in the name of Jesus. We got power in the name of Jesus. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. You know, we have power in the blood of Jesus over all the power of the enemy. Jesus said, I give you power over all the power of the enemy. You know, and we have the power to walk across the top, walk over scorpions and snakes. They can't hurt us. Nothing by any means will hurt you, the Lord said. Every hair on our head is counted. If God be for you, who can be against you? You need to renew your mind with the Word of God. These Bible verses I'm quoting to you. You need to bring your every thought in vain imagination. You know, bring those thoughts into captivity, the Bible says. Bring all your vain imaginations, all your wild imaginations about Obama being the Antichrist, or, you know, maybe that you're paranoid that the NSA is listening to your conversations, or all your vain imaginations. Bring it into subjection to the Word of God. Look, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. You must seek the Lord. You need to seek the Lord. Lots of you have problems with your husband or your wife. You have problems with your job or your business. You have trouble with pornography, with alcohol, masturbation, whatever. I hate to mention these things. You have trouble with something like that. And it's all boils down to renewing your mind that every temptation, God provides a way of escape, and He will not let you be overtaken in temptation. Now, all of us, including myself, we're overtaken in temptation, whatever it may be. It may be temptation to eat too much. It may be temptation. Of course, I don't smoke or anything, but maybe your temptation is smoking. Lots of people talk to me about that, or buying lottery tickets, gambling, whatever, drinking. There's one brother that talks to me all the time to pray for him to be delivered from the homosexuality. More than one brother, two or three brothers. Many people, pornography, many, especially men, pornography, masturbation, all this kind of stuff. Sin is sin. People have lots of different sins, but it's a matter of renewing your mind. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You must stand. Our faith, besides just generally, I have faith in Jesus Christ. But it's Bible verses. That's why I need to do teaching. And nobody wants sound doctrine, but I'm going to teach it. There's a sister that told me, oh, Pastor Patrick, I wish you could go give more meat more time, more of the time. You've been, you know, you're having to do all this stuff for the baby milk people. That's true. And like I said, I'm going to stop worried about the Pharisees and trying to answer them. I already did that. And, of course, I got to have some milk for new people. And people that are new Christians are not Christians who want to be Christians. But I need to have more meat in there, and I'm going to keep kicking it up. I'm going to do a whole series on faith, because the key to revival and all that for people that are Christians is just faith in the power of God. Faith. Look, stop looking at that giant of the Antichrist spirit over the United States and over the world. And stop saying, oh, well, this is it, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, the rapture may be tomorrow, but what if it's not? What if it's 10 years from now? What if they declare martial law and the rapture still hasn't happened yet? I'm not saying there won't be. I believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, but there's nothing saying like, there's a guy that has a blog talk radio that's pretty famous. He's always mocking every radio show he does. I tried to listen to him because he had some pretty good guests. But all he does is keep mocking preacher of rapture people. What's his name? Anyway, he's got a big radio show. I think he's in Dallas, Texas, as a matter of fact. And he's saying that, what are the pre-trib rapture people going to say if there's a nuclear explosion in Los Angeles and Los Angeles is wiped out? Then what are they going to do? There could be a nuclear bomb in California and it has nothing to do with the tribulation. The Bible doesn't say there can be no nuclear bombs in Los Angeles until the rapture happens and the tribulation starts. We don't know that. We don't know what all we'll see. We had World War II and there was no rapture. We had nuclear bombs in Japan and there was no rapture. We had the attack on Pearl Harbor. We had 9/11 and there was no rapture at that time. That it doesn't say what horrible things we might see before there is the rapture. Okay? It could be a massive earthquake in the United States. It could kill millions of people in California, whatever. Maybe not. You don't know that. It's not Richard Land. Anyway, we don't know what we can see in this world. And we need to get our eyes off of what the government's doing in the New World Order. Even though I talked about that a lot in the book, and I said in the book, these are just so we can tell the world, hey, look, these are the signs. Everything's in place for the tribulation. And we can look and say, hey, everything's coming together for the tribulation to begin. Not to be afraid, but to be informed of what's going on. That's the purpose of the news. It's not the job of preachers to come on and sensationalize every little news story and, oh, you know, that it's fulfillment of Bible prophecy and all that. That's not true. All of these things are little dots on the map that say, hey, you know, little dots of pixels in the picture that says, the tribulation is at hand, even at the door, as the Lord said. But we still have an obligation. We still have a responsibility. We still have lost sheep that need to come home. The fullness of the Gentiles has not come in, obviously, because if the fullness of the Gentiles, as the Lord Jesus Christ said, had come in and the age of the Gentiles was fulfilled, then the rapture would happen and the tribulation would begin. So obviously it hasn't happened because the Lord hasn't came down for the rapture. So we know that we still have something to do. There's still at least one more person that needs to get saved. Because if it was complete and the job was done, we would be raptured. So we have a job to do. And it's not to be filled with fear. And it's not to be fretting and worried about trying to calculate the day of the rapture. Or trying to worry about what's happening in the news. Our job is to seek the Lord and ask the Lord to tell us what we need to do. Lead us step by step by His Spirit, what we need to go and do and say to who, when, where, why, and how to get the job done and do our last mission, like the title of the book. Final boarding call, Satan's plan for the ages, New World Order, our last mission. This is our last mission. We need to hear from God how to do our last mission. It's not going to be done the way it was done before. It's not going to be done. That's the problem with all these churches. They're still back there at the what God did 200 years ago, talking about, what happened? Hey, that was before the move of God has moved on beyond you. And stop calling people that's in the move of God beyond you heretics. God moves in various ways amongst every generation in a different way to bring about the salvation of the lost. And that's what it's all about, bringing in the sheaves. It's not about, trying to copy, the church like a, you know, at the church I used to go to before I became a pastor, there's that Coral Ridge Church in Florida, you know, the Presbyterian Church, and the pastor's dead now. He's a good speaker. What's his name? Anyway, he started this thing, Evangelism Explosion, where you go two by two, and then when you get somebody else saved, they go with another person. Every person that gets saved, it's like a pyramid thing, and then they go evangelize. Evangelism Explosion. All the churches are trying to copy that. Look, God did that one way through one ministry in one place in one time. God is not a formula like the Jehovah Witnesses and the Mormons and all that. They're spouting some formula. God is the great I Am. He is living and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword, dividing asunder the thoughts and intents of the heart. You know, even the bone and marrow, He divides it, even the thoughts and intents of our heart. God has an exact way of explaining the gospel to each individual person, whether they need to see somebody get healed, like I was talking about, they need to see somebody speak in tongues, or they need to hear John 3:16, or they need to be told, are you going to hell if you don't get saved? Or they need to get an answered prayer, or they need to see a baby cry. Whatever it takes, God has a different way of showing it. Or they need to get cancer, or they need to go to jail, or they need to go through a divorce, or whatever it is that would lead. God already knows everything. God has an ordered way. He knows every person that's going to get saved, and what it takes for them to get saved. Whatever it is, God will do that. Jesus will leave the 99 and go get the one. So our goal is to be flexible and open and walking in the Spirit that God can use us to be a, you know, offer our bodies as a living sacrifice, Romans chapter 12, verse 1, acceptable and pleasing unto God, that God can use us. You know, there's a Bible verse back there, I think in Proverbs, it says, you know, it's easier to, you know, to steer a moving, you know, a mule. It's better to be a wild mule, you know, that you're trying to handle than a mule that won't move at all. Something like that is what the Bible verse says. You know, and the saying is, it's easier to turn a steering car than a parked car. Most of you guys are parked cars. You need to get moving so that God can steer you. You know, it's better to try and miss the mark than to do nothing at all, because, you know, it's like an old mule. You can't do nothing with it. Most of you are like that. So anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. You know, I always keep going. I want to preach. I got lots of preaching I want to do. It's hard to hear in the hotel, you know. My wife and son are outside right now, and they're waiting on me to finish to come back inside. So I'm going to get off here. God bless you guys. Love you guys. Message me, and let's lock in these plans. You got a desire in your heart to win your relatives. You're going to coordinate getting them together, and I'm going to come there and do my part. Let's do it. Let's win the lost. Let's do it one house at a time. As the Lord leads, a revival could break out at your house. You don't know that God could use you as an instrument, and revival break out of the whole United States right in your house. It's you know, God can, I don't know how God's going to do it or what he's going to do, you know, and I'm just along for the ride just like anybody else. And I'm just walking by faith 100%. I'm going to start doing teachings on faith step by step. And, you know, those who are wanting to meet will follow me. Those who are looking for the next dream about the rapture, they'll still be here having dreams about the rapture and still here. And still when the days of our judgment, you know, for our rewards, they're going to be coming up short, because it's like it's all about them and not about you know, doing the Lord's mission. God bless you guys. Love you. I don't care if people get upset or not. That's the thing about me. I'm not a people pleaser. That's why God uses me. I am not moved by people being happy about what I said, and I'm not moved by people being upset. But, you know, it does encourage me personally in my flesh if people say, hey, that was a good message. But it doesn't move me. I'm only concerned to say what God wants me to say. You need to be the same way. If you're trying to deal with your relatives, of course, we're not out to hurt people and, you know, purposely make people upset. But Jesus said, you know, they hated me, they'll hate you also. No servant is above his master. It's be great if a servant is like his master. You know, so they killed Jesus. They killed the apostles. They killed almost all the prophets in the Old Testament. So we shouldn't expect any different from the world. We're a sweet smelling savor to those who are being saved. And we're a stench in the nostrils of those who are going to hell. And that's a fact. That's what it is. So I'm not a people pleaser, and it, you know, people that, you know, would say a negative comment to me, it doesn't move me. They're wasting their time. And for you guys, you need to have that same, let the same mind be in you, that you're not moved. I shall not be moved. My feet are on the rock of Jesus Christ and his word. That now I'm moved if I'm wrong about something. See what I'm saying? If I'm wrong, if someone says to you, hey, you got that theologically wrong, you're wrong in what you said in the Bible. Then you think about it. You consider it. You be wise. You know, a wise man takes a rebuke. You take a rebuke if you're wise. If you're a fool, you get mad. That's what the Bible says. So you take a rebuke and you consider it. Are they right or not? You know, I'm giving the other side of this equation here to keep it balanced, not to give people the wrong idea. And you take a rebuke. You take correction. A wise man or a wise woman takes correction, the Bible says in Proverbs. A fool gets mad if you know. So we take correction, but when someone says to you, I'm not saying what you're saying is wrong. I'm saying you're not being politically correct by what you say. Like if I said, oh, homosexuality is a sin. You cannot be a born-again Christian and go to heaven if you're practicing homosexuality, or even if you're practicing, you're a drug addict and you say you're a Christian and then you're not repentive of your drug addictness. Now you're trying to quit. Maybe some people are delivered instantly from drugs or homosexuality, and some people, they have to go to some kind of counseling or whatever, you know, whatever it takes. You're making an active effort. You're trying to repent. You're turning from it. God knows your heart. You're giving your best effort. Okay, God is the judge in that. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that people that say, hey, I'm a practicing homosexual and it's not a sin, and God thinks it's great and I'm still going to heaven, and I don't need to repent of it because it's not a sin. Now, see, that's what I'm talking about. And our drugs or whatever you're talking about. Now, when someone says to me, hey, I don't believe homosexuality is a sin. You're a liar. You suck. That part of the Bible sucks. I'm throwing it out. You know, I'm using the S. U-X, okay? That's a horrible thing. I don't agree with you. You're evil because you're a hater, blah, blah, blah. That doesn't move me, because I know what the Word of God says. and I'm standing on the Word of God. I don't care what anybody thinks. Okay? Just like, let that mind be in you. Don't be moved by the world. Don't be trying to be a people pleaser. God hates people pleasers. You need to be a God pleaser. Don't be a people pleaser. That's the problem with most people. They're appeasers. They're compromisers. They sell out their soul for just so somebody won't be angry at them. You know, and I have a lot of lukewarm relatives that are like that. You know, they try to be friends with the world and friends with God. You can't be. The Bible says if you're a friend of the world, you're an enemy of God. Get off the fence. That's what I'm saying. It's really the message for the church, for revival. That's another way of saying it. Get your blessed assurance off the fence. You know, choose this day whom you will serve. For as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I believe that's Joshua 24:17 or 25:17. I can't remember. God bless you guys. Love you guys. Hey, it's not about being a stickler and all this, about perfection. The Word of God is in my heart. Those Bible verses were added in the 1400s, and even the chapters weren't added until the 9th or 10th century. So the original text, there are no chapters and verses. That's just for our reference to where they are in the Bible. God bless you guys.